that music. The cliche has it that it isn't a question of whether we are going to have national health insurance, but when and of what kind. There are 16 bills in Congress awaiting action, but only three of them are thought of having any chance at all of passing. And one of these, the organized labor bill, which wouldn't affect socialized health services, lags behind the two major bills, one of them the administration bill, the other the Kennedy-Mills bill. Senator Kennedy began by backing the labor bill, but has moved towards something less than that, in the direction of Nixon's bill. Both of them propose, in effect, a government role in ensuring low-income Americans against moderate medical bills and all hospital bills, and other Americans against immoderate medical bills and most hospital bills. The bones of contention seem to be, one, how much, if anything, should be deductible, two, is there a role for the private insurance companies, and three, how best to disguise from the people the fact that they are paying the bills. Mr. Max Fine of San Francisco is the executive director of the Committee for National Health Insurance and an ardent advocate of a federal bill. He was born in Nashville, Tennessee, has served as a journalist covering the United Nations and subsequently as press officer for Dag Hammarskjöld, and then to Washington with the HEEW, and he has recently worked with the AFL and CIO. Dr. Russell Roth of Erie, Pennsylvania, who has been serving as president of the American Medical Association, is a urologist who took his undergraduate degree at Yale and his medical degree at Johns Hopkins. He favors a plan called MediCredit, the financing of voluntary health insurance through a balance of private and public dollars and income tax credits. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Roth why, considering that New York and California are the richest states in the Union, it is necessary for Washington, D.C. to worry about their medical problems.
Well, we're talking about a social idea whose time has come, according to our nation's leading phrasemaker, Richard Nixon, that we need a national health insurance.
I thought that was John Reed.
No, it was currently Richard Nixon. We need a national health insurance program that would implement the principle of health care as a right. Everyone ought to be covered, and virtually everything ought to be covered, to take the provision of health insurance out of the marketplace, put it under Social Security. There are still many people in New York and California who have no health insurance. And since medical costs in those two states are much higher than in most other states, you can imagine the plight of those people. Matter of fact, just the other day in the Los Angeles Times, there was an ad running, doctors wanted to work one day, half a day a week, either in the afternoon or the evening, $50,000 for a half a day's work. So you can imagine if that's the price that is being paid for a half a day's work, what the costs are to people in California.
Well, isn't it your assumption that most of the congressmen and senators from California and New York, let's leave out senators for personal convenience, are going to vote for one of these bills, in which case, what's to prevent them from voting for their own local bills, achieving the same effect for their own people? Why do you insist on incorporating California and New York in your...
Because it's a national problem. The problem is partly the cost of medical care, and to most people, the so-called crisis in healthcare boils down to costs, but it's also a problem of chronic manpower shortage, particularly a physician shortage. And the only way that we're even halfway satisfying the need for medical care in this country is by importing foreign physicians, particularly from countries that need them far worse than we do, countries like the Philippines and India. It's also a crisis of lack of evenness to the quality in the system, and disorganized services. We have some of the finest medical services in the world in this country, but for most people, they're simply not available, and they aren't organized well for the average working family.
What, no offense intended, what makes you think that you can organize medicine having screwed up practically everything else that you've tried to organize from the post office on down?
Well, of course, I don't speak for labor. Labor happens
to
support...
Well, I wasn't thinking of you as labor. I was thinking of you as sort of a government advocate.
I'm an advocate of the Social Security system. I think it works very well. I think the checks all arrive the third of the month. Nobody has to look around for the check. It's a system where the people who work in it have been oriented from the beginning to treat the beneficiary as one who's entitled to his benefits, not one to be questioned. It's a system where the people generally support it. It should be expanded. It's worked well for 35 years, and we believe that the missing link is health insurance.
It hasn't worked well at all.
Social Security's worked very well.
Well, not in terms of the people who wrote the bill, because the people who wrote Social Security are more or less guaranteed that it would never end up with a levy in excess of 2%. It's now up to, 11%? If it was 100%, presumably it would work better by your standards, but they are a little simplistic.
Well, it's 5.85% on the first 13,200, which of course
for each.
Yes, for the individual, yeah. And for the employer.
Yeah, which means really all for the employer, doesn't it?
Well, I think
I don't want to turn this into an economic show, but I do think that economic problems, as Dr. Roth I think will confirm, have to be thought about, don't they?
They certainly do. But we're not talking about new money here. We're talking about the employer who is now paying billions of dollars for private health insurance, shifting that over through the Social Security contribution. And no new money on the employer, the same that he's paying now. But with that trust fund, you can have the leverage and the support to create reforms in the healthcare system and to control costs.
Why do we have the post office run this?
I think the post office has done a particularly poor job since it reverted back to a quasi-public rather than a public utility.
Well, why have the telephone companies done so well, which have been private?
Well, I'm not proposing that the telephone companies do this or anything else. I'm proposing that we rely on the Social Security system.
Well, let's turn to Dr. Roth, because I do think that the tendency in America has been always to accept the socialist cliché at a moment when it is least needed. We turned education of the public schools, the financing of it, to the government after it was absolutely established that we didn't need to. And it seems to me this is exactly what we're about to do to medicine. Is that your impression, Dr. Roth?
Well, I couldn't agree more. You know, may I throw in a wry observation about the post office department? If you talk about, I think you said 14 or 16 major bills before Congress on national health insurance, and I'm thinking of proposing a 17th one, the Roth bill, which is zeroed in on the poor record we are supposed to have in this country on infant mortality. And my bill would turn all the obstetrical care over to the post office department on the hope that they would do better delivering the female than they have done delivering the male.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. That's an after-dinner joke. Huh? Well, what I'd like to know is this, since we have approximately 90% coverage at the moment, correct?
No, that's not correct,
not
at
correct?
All. Uh-huh. The government figures show that there are about 30 million people in this country who have no coverage whatsoever. But those who have coverage may have only $15 a day coverage when they're in the hospital. The hospital costs may average $200. They're counted among the people who are covered. You can't get any data from the insurance industry on the quality of the coverage. And therefore, you know nothing about the coverage unless you know about the quality. We do know that all the coverage in the country, private health insurance, only covers about one-third of health care costs.
Well, do we know why health care has gone up as much as it has in the last period? Why has it gone up four times, for instance, in the last 12 or 15 years? Has this to do with the increased quality of it, of the care, or with extravagance, or what?
Partly. I think it's the quality has improved. I think that the inflation in health care, which, of course, over the last 20 years, the costs of health care have gone up at 2.5 times the rate of wage increases. But the cost problem is partly a problem of waste. We have hospitals all over the country with empty beds, overbuilt facilities, open-heart surgery teams which aren't needed, exotic and exquisite materials and equipment and so forth that are in no rationally way planned. We're wasting a great deal of money. We also have no controls of any substance on physicians' fees. or other fees of other providers of services. We have basically a marketplace in which the supply is short, the demand is increasing. Television helps increase this demand, all that gee whiz medicine, Dr. Welby and so forth. And as the demand increases, the supply is getting worse. So the costs and the expenditures increase far beyond other items in the cost of living index over a long period of time.
What do you say to that, Dr. Roth?
Well, I don't think that any of it is very valid, but it does focus on the fact that Mr. Fine and many other people in the Washington area are primarily interested in costs and not in quality. And I doubt that this is really true of the American public in general. I have to start out disagreeing with the allegation of crisis, because actually more people are receiving more and better medical care in more and better equipped facilities from more and better trained physicians than ever before in history, and that really doesn't sound like crisis. The only crisis is in the cost area, and although we were there first with the most and the highest visibility, everything else has caught up with us, and in the physician's component, most things have passed us. Institutional care is still a leader in the economic spiral toward inflation for a variety of well-understood reasons, bringing their pay scales up to date, buying the expensive equipment which goes along with the progress that you make in kidney machines and intensive care units, coronary care, and so on. So the costs have gone up. But really, the people in this country accept this with a fair degree of complacency. If you can believe in polling techniques, a recent Harris poll showed that when people were asked what their biggest concern was, inflation was number one, and healthcare was number 15 out of 16. And so when we want to talk about great plans to legislate in the area of medical care and to throw public resources in, our question, or my question, is, does the public really want to aggravate worry number one, inflation, in order to do something of questionable validity about number 15, health care?
May I comment on another poll? Because Gallup also had a poll in 71 and 72 which showed that two-thirds of the American people believe that we need basic reforms in the health care system, and about two-thirds felt that we ought to have national health insurance. And even among Republicans, more than two out of three felt that this national health insurance program ought to be administered by the federal government and not by state government or by insurance companies. Now, the matter of quality, I think sort of typifying the problem is a report not so long ago by the Inter-Society Commission on Heart Disease, which is a medical society organism, which pointed out that in New York City, for example, there were 15 open heart surgery teams. And seven of them do 85% of the open heart surgery. The other eight are paid for because we pay hospitals on the basis of cost plus reimbursement. They are maintained even though those other eight open heart surgery teams were not performing the minimal 50 operations a year to make them proficient.
Paid by whom?
Paid by Blue Cross, paid by insurance companies, paid by Medicare, paid by the multiplicity of sources that pay hospitals.
But he makes it sound as though these open-heart surgeons are like firemen sitting around in their open-heart operating room doing nothing in the meantime. Now, you don't have to go back very far to remember the day when we had no open-heart surgical facilities. We had no open-heart surgery. And we're making immense progress. And I would submit that it might be a delinquency on the part of any planning group if you're putting in a modern hospital designed to take care of the needs as best you can see them for the next 20 or 30 years if you didn't plan to put in the facilities for this developing kind of surgery.
Well, but isn't Mr. Fine saying that they're being paid for doing nothing?
I challenge this. Well, I think this is mythology.
Well, of course, this is in the report of the Inter-Society Commission on Heart Disease, that they were being paid even though they do not have the proficiency to provide good open heart surgery. And the payment is coming because the method of payment in this country for hospitals is cost plus reimbursement, mm-hmm. which we want to change. We believe that hospitals ought to budget on a prospective basis, and also that physicians' costs and other provider costs ought to be anchored to a budget developed in advance, negotiated in advance. We do not believe that physicians or dentists or others should, for the future, arbitrarily set fees and you pay, particularly since society is paying 95% of the cost of medical education, dental education. The future should hold the principle of health care as a right. We're the only industrial country which hasn't yet enacted either a national health service or national health insurance program. Canada was the latest to do so.
Well, that's not really true. Well, you know, West Germany finances its scheme entirely out of insurance contributions.
West Germany, however, has a federal program which was actually started by Bismarck almost 100 years ago. They were the first.
Yeah, but it's not a program that sets up, in effect, national medicine. It sets up national insurance.
Every country has a unique program. In
yeah.
Canada, they have a national health insurance program. But Canada's program is 50% funded by the federal government of Canada and 50% by the provinces. We're talking about something different in this country. Every country has a uniquely national health plan. We don't have. We just have a lot of pieces lying around.
Well, what, Dr. Roth, what if you were left to your own devices, what would you do to help these 30 million people that Mr. Fine has identified as having insufficient medical care?
Well, happily, while the debate goes on, I think the medical societies are doing a great deal. This is why I'm able to say that more people are getting more and better care than ever before in history, because this is exactly the way it's going. Now, I don't agree with Mr. Fine's statistics, and when you consider that the great bulk of the poor are covered by the Medicaid program and the elderly by the Medicare program.
Did you approve of those when they came along?
The Medicaid program was a sound philosophy, but it fell flat on its face when it depended on financing by a conjunction between the federal government and the states, and it's never been adequately financed to do the job it was conceived to do. Medicare has been more of a success. I would say it's done a moderate amount of good, but at a rather immoderate cost. And this is the problem. You can't say bad things about Medicare. It's done an awful lot of good for a lot of people. But people tend to forget that we in the medical profession had a bill that we thought would do the same things for people at much reduced expenses. But you have to go back to the debate of 9 and 10 years ago to remember about those things. And we're in this same situation now. We have this bill that you referred to, Medicredit.
Would you describe that for us?
Yeah, I'd be delighted. Let's say first, if it were in force tomorrow, this would mean that everyone in the United States would have within economic reach a policy or a contract which would entitle them to coverage for 60 days of general hospital care, including psychiatric hospital care. Some trade-offs on long-term nursing home care, up to 120 days, outpatient hospital services, home health care, physician services wherever rendered, home, office, or hospital, dental care for children, and then what's generally called a catastrophic or umbrella type of coverage that cuts in after the individual or the family has spent as much as 10% of the net taxable income. And after this much expenditure, the policy would cut in and take the rest of the expenses, covered expenses, on to infinity. Now, how do you get this? Eligibility. We use the federal income tax as our existing yardstick, and we follow the general principle that he who owes no income tax, no dollars to Washington, almost by definition has no disposable dollars that he can use to buy insurance with or pay for medical care. So we'd give him the piece of paper that he can carry into the insurance company or the health plan of his choice and turn it in as his year's premium.
And who finances that?
This comes out of general revenues of the federal government. Mm. And then a notch above this are the people who are clearly not on welfare, the blue-collar workers, the low- and middle-income people who are above welfare, but they have some income tax that they have to pay to Washington, and we use this as evidence of the fact that they have some dollars that could be used for this purpose, to pay at least part of their premium cost. And so we have really what's a sliding scale. As the income tax goes up, the individual is expected to pay more and more of the cost of this total premium, up to a 90% level, and beyond that, everybody gets a 10% federal subsidy, which is equivalent to approximately the present income tax deduction that you can take on your health insurance premium, and also an incentive to get in and be covered, because ours is a voluntary system. We wouldn't force it on anybody who didn't want it. So that it's financed, we think, maximally between general revenues and private contributions. And this sliding scale is where we our tax credits get in, because that's the way we handle the part of the government's part of the subsidy is a direct tax credit, not a deduction, but a tax credit.
Now, what's wrong with that, Dr. Stein?
Well, Medicredit is really a $12 billion rate on the Treasury.
Explain that, would you?
That's right. All that would happen under Medicredit is people would go out and be encouraged to buy the worst kind of health insurance policies, the individual and family policies that only return 50 cents on the dollar. That would be an encouragement for them to do that. The doctors would continue to charge their usual and customary fees without any control on the fees. If that program were ever enacted, a lot of doctors would have to leave the country after a few years, because the people would become so outraged with the increase in costs that would occur that they'd be even madder then than they are at some doctors today.
Why wouldn't there be competition among doctors?
Because we don't have enough doctors.
Well, why don't we have enough doctors?
Because over a period of years, the AMA and the American Association of Medical Colleges have not encouraged the development of more places in medical schools. As a matter of fact, in years when the AMA was thought to support such development under Senator Taft in 1949, at the last minute they withdrew their support of this of his program, and Taft had to go on the Senate floor and say he's sorry, but his program to increase the number of places in medical schools had no longer had the support of the AMA, and he had to withdraw it. Therefore, we waited until 1963 before we passed the first ever Health Professions Educational Assistance Act. And since that time, we have increased the number of medical schools somewhat. But still, 50% of all the physicians who were newly licensed to practice medicine in America last year were foreign trained. We're stealing them from the Philippines and India and underdeveloped countries instead of providing the opportunities for well-qualified young people in this country to become physicians.
What's your comment on that, Dr. Roth?
Well, it's quite an impressive string of mythological statements. In the first place, well, I scarcely know where to begin, but let's start with the
How many doctors are there per Americans now compared to, say, 50 years ago?
Well, it's increasing at the rate of three times the rate of the population growth. 50 years ago takes us right back to a critical point, because that's the last time you could really say that the American Medical Association did anything to reduce the production of physicians a little bit more than 50 years ago. It was around 1912, 1913, when the American Medical Association, together with the Carnegie Foundation, carried out what's generally referred to as the Flexner Commission report. And there were about 160 medical schools or organizations granting MD degrees at that time, most of which, or many of which, were diploma mills and fly-by-night organizations. And we did cooperate with Dr. Flexner and the Carnegie Foundation in running them out of business and getting down to a bedrock of institutions with some criteria of excellence in medical education. And we've been increasing this number ever since. Now, my personal association, From the time I graduated from medical school, there were, I believe, 72 medical schools. There are now 114 that have students in them. And there has been something in excess of an overall excess of 10% increase in the size of classes, and this is rapidly expanding, so that we indeed are producing physicians at a rate three times as fast as the population growth. And there are those, I hasten to say I don't agree with them, but there are those who are worrying right now about overproducing physicians by as early as 1980.
You mean at this rate, or if you continue to expand?
If you continue to expand.
Well, but Mr. Fine has a pretty solid point, doesn't he, when he says that 50% of the people who were licensed were trained outside the United States last year, which certainly suggests
50%
of a terrific shortage, right?
50% of the people who were licensed last year,
yeah.
I believe, I think that's essentially correct. And we do have problems, but, you know, you can go on increasing the number of physicians, and as long as you have the demand factor increasing just as rapidly, you're never going to catch up with it. I think we can look at Russia and see this, where they have twice as many physicians per 100,000 people as we do, and they are continuing to produce physicians at the same rate of speed, and they have seven applicants for every place they have in medical school as against our three. And I don't know that you can use the demand of people that want to get into medical school as any criterion by which you judge how many physicians you should have.
Well, what does it suggest, that there's a sort of a lack of native skill medicine, that we have to bring in Pakistanis and Mexicans and Indians?
Well, I don't know that you have to bring them in. As a matter of fact, this is not an area in which we have any great say. It is a policy of the State Department and the immigration laws that are admitting physicians. And obviously there are superbly trained physicians coming from these foreign schools. It isn't too terribly long ago, but the hallmark of education in this country in medicine was to have been in Edinburgh or to have been in Vienna or someplace like that. And we don't have a corner on excellence in medical education. Some of these people coming in are fine, but this does not mean that they are coming in response to any national demand. They're coming in because they don't like the prospects of a lifetime of practice in their own areas. And then you have a new phenomenon where physicians are being trained for export by specially designed schools, such as the one in Guadalajara, and there has been one in Bologna, but they are diffusing that. And these are schools to which American students flock when they can't get into the American medical schools.
Yeah. Well, is it, Mr. Fine, is it your point that doctors as a profession are emulating the habits of some of the trade unions, driving their prices up by restricting the number of people who are admitted into the profession?
No, not at all. I think that the medical profession, over a period of years, by exercising this professional birth control, and I'm reminded of the chairman of the AMA Council on Medical Education over a period of a quarter century, Dr. Arthur Dean Bevan, who called for a reduction in the number of places in medical school throughout the Depression years, so that the opposition of the AMA to increase places in medical schools goes well beyond the 1924 period. But this has no analogy whatsoever to the trade union movement. The trade unions have never restricted the opportunities for people to be become members of the union.
Oh, sure they have.
In effect, we have a situation here where the AMA has called the tune on the number of physicians, not only for the period immediately behind us, but also for the decade ahead, at least.
Well, you obviously restrict an opportunity to enter the profession if you require that you be a member of the union in order practice, and if there are more people who apply than there are spaces, like plumbers in New York or bricklayers or electricians or whatever.
May I point out that
this is a universal phenomenon, isn't it? The business is trying to protect your profession by finding reasons for making it difficult to enter it.
I think there's quite a difference between talking about skilled or unskilled working people and talking about a profession that holds life and death in its hands.
Well, I think that's a genteel point, but after all, electricians hold life and death in their hands.
In their own hands, but not somebody else's.
Sort of elevator operators. I think the principle
is. I doubt that we've restricted the number of elevator operators.
There seems to be no answer to this simply by socializing medicine, because I know that the number of doctors who leave England, which is almost totally socialized as medicine, is one out of three, and they're depending very heavily on Pakistanis and Indians and so on and so forth.
Well, that's right.
So your bill isn't going to cure that problem, is it?
Well, our bill is not socialized medicine, and
no.
I think we ought to clear that up to begin with.
Yeah, what do
we're
we call
not
it?
Talking about the doctors becoming civil servants. We're not talking about the
but
government
regulate,
taking over
you're
the hospital.
You're going to regulate what they can
we're
charge,
we're talking
right?
about Social Security. In 1934 and 1935, we came very close in the original Social Security Act to covering health as well as providing the cash benefit program. We're talking about under the Social Security program, providing benefits rather than buying private insurance policies of the type that Dr. Roth and the AMA would have us buy. We think the Social Security Administration can provide universal coverage.
Suppose I disagree with you. Would I be free to disagree with you?
Surely.
Under your bill?
To disagree with
yeah,
me?
And not to take your policy?
No, it would be compulsory in this sense. Everybody in the country would be covered. Now, there is no relationship between the coverage and the entitlement to benefits. In other words, if you're working, you would pay a tax for this. If you're not working, you're still covered. So that the provision of the benefit is yours if you live in this country. We'd be catching up with other countries.
No, I wouldn't have the choice.
I'd
have to subscribe to your system.
You wouldn't have to use the medical care system at all if you didn't want to.
I just pay for it.
If you wanted to, you could use it. You'd be covered by it. Yeah. Since you're working, you would pay for it.
But and you would dictate the wages of the doctors. That is to say, you would say such and such is okay to charge for an appendicitis, or
we would negotiate a reasonable fee.
I know it's reasonable. I'm sure you wouldn't be unreasonable. But nothing is socialized, but the doctors have to charge a particular rate, and the citizens have to pay to inscribe in the system. Otherwise, it's free.
Well, the doctor, that's right. The doctor could not charge the patient additional amounts as they can now under Blue Shield.
What if you wanted
I would like
to
just go back to socialized medicine for one more moment. President Nixon really has confused this issue around socialized medicine, because he keeps calling this bill that we're supporting socialized medicine. The last time was the day that he came out of the Bethesda Naval Hospital, and he said the day after he came out of the hospital, he went down to Miami and opened a hospital down there and used the occasion to denounce our bill and said that when he goes in the hospital, he wants those doctors to be working for him, the patient,
mm-hmm.
and not to be working for the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
Well, all the doctors in Bethesda Naval Hospital are working for the federal government. He doesn't have anything against socialized medicine so long as the people don't get in on it. Now, it's also true that physicians get free medical care, and often their families get free medical care, and that's been called socialized medicine. It isn't necessarily socialized medicine. It means they don't pay for services at the time services are delivered. We're talking about that same kind of system. You pay in advance through Social Security. You don't pay at the time services are delivered. That way you're going to encourage preventive medicine. You're going to encourage early diagnosis of disease. Right here in the state of Pennsylvania, 2 years ago, 2,500 women died of cervical cancer. Now, I'm sure that Dr. Roth could tell you, as other physicians would, that when caught early, when diagnosed early, this is not a lethal form of cancer. Women should not be dying of this disease. It's happening because preventive medicine is not universally available. As a matter of fact, it's not often available even to working people.
Has there been any study done as to the income of the people who died of cervical cancer? Is there an absolute correlation between the poor people who died is there a correlation, an economic correlation, and
well,
the incidence of disease?
I think it's true that the poor suffer more than other groups in terms of the healthcare system. But these data go right across the board. It's a system where preventive medicine is neither practiced nor sought. And we do not believe that we ought to continue to have these artificial barriers against it, financial barriers in the form of deductibles and coinsurance. Dr. Roth's bill, the president's bill, all the other bills impose these deductibles, high deductibles, co-insurance payments. We believe that these should be removed. People would have an opportunity to come in without those barriers. If the AMA is so interested in these deductibles and co-insurance, I think that they ought to think in terms of a $10,000 deductible on malpractice insurance and 25% copay. That way, we'll reduce the incidence of unnecessary surgery and get at the quality problem, which we haven't talked about yet.
Do you have a comment on that, Dr. Roth?
Well, yes, I certainly do. I wish that the approach that Mr. Fine talks about had any real hope for solving the problems. Well, we recognize the problems. The last thing in the world we are saying is that health care is perfect. There are problems of access, there are problems of quality, and there are problems of cost. And the difficulty is to decide what you can legislate answers to and what you can solve by simply pumping more dollars into the system. Now, unhappily, dollars are not the answer. Those of us who practice medicine know that on fewer and fewer occasions are people not getting care because they can't pay for it or because nobody else will pay for it. But we're still seeing these problems of cancer of the cervix, and there's no way to solve the problem for the woman who won't come in and take advantage of the programs which are paid for, available free, or that somebody else will pay for her. The ignorance, fear, patient neglect, faith in substitutes for good medical care, the quackeries, the frauds, and so on. These are barriers that are now becoming more important than the dollar barrier. And this is why we think our Medicredit bill is appropriate, because it zeroes in specifically on the remaining dollar barrier for what it's worth. And you could legislate our way out of that one and get down to the serious barriers that stand between people and good health care. Their proposal of Kennedy One, or I don't know, it's, you see, Mr. Kennedy has turned his back on the program that Mr. Fine's been talking about, and he has now effected a little compromise with Mr. Mills, probably because it looked as though Senator Long was getting ahead with his Long-Ribicoff bill. And I don't think the important thing is what big name is on the bill. In fact, I think this is probably undesirable. We have more sponsors on our bill for what they're worth than any of the other bills, and I guess maybe than all the rest of them put together. We have 182 senators and congressmen that are co-sponsoring our bill. I don't really think that's what counts. What counts is what does it do for people? And what is it going to do to access, to quality, and to cost? And cost right now seems to be uppermost in everyone's mind because of inflation. So we are offering a proposal from the point of view of the practicing physicians, the ones that have to do the work under any system that may be legislated upon us. And we think this is one we can live with, that we can do the most good, we can come the closest to bringing the right answers to the people. And this rationing care, the way the Kennedy One bill would do that Mr. Fine is advocating, seems to me to be quite wrong. Because its philosophy is to decide how many dollars you're going to spend in this country and then parcel them out around the country in regions and sub-regions and so on, pre-negotiate with institutions.
Yeah, I don't understand, Mr. Fine, why if you could reasonably expect everything that you have described flow out of this bill, England wouldn't have, with its 20-year history of it, wouldn't be enjoying the benefits. And yet we know that in England you've got to wait sometimes 7 or 8 months to enter a hospital. We know that a doctor makes only $14,500 a year. We know that he has up to 2,500 patients that he has to look after. We know that in England there's a tremendous scarcity, as I say, of hospital beds. That is, a percentage of the income less is spent on medical care by far than here. And yet all of it is all neatly bundled together under the beverage plan. Aren't you really indulging less a knowledge of medical needs than the old-fashioned liberal superstition.
No, not at all.
That the government is going to solve everything.
In the first place, again, we're not talking about a program like England's. However, the other thing that's true about England's program is that the people of England esteem it very highly. I don't think you'd find very many people in England who would tell you they'd like to get rid of that program.
They esteem George III also.
Well, they're satisfied with their program, and so are the three political parties, all of which claim credit for the National Health Service. If any government in England tried to get rid of the National Health Service, the people would get rid of that government very quickly. The people of England like the National Health Service, but that is not what we're talking about.
Well,
we're talking about
like
a Social Security
doctors.
Program.
The point is we ought to be able to learn from other people's
experiences. Well, I think the quality of care in England
and
is
the fact
is
that
very
they
good.
Like it is just immaterial. The question is, would the people of cervical cancer that you point out to have had the same experience in England as here?
No, I think you find some quality.
I think you find some
quality assurances in England that you don't have here.
Name one.
One of them is that when you're operated on in England, you're absolutely going to be operated on in a hospital by a qualified physician.
8 months after you've put in for it.
Well, but maybe you don't need the surgery. I mean, who says that we have so much more diseased organs in this country? People are getting operated on in this country unnecessarily, particularly female surgery, back surgery. The mine workers, for example, not so long ago imposed a new condition, namely a second opinion by a qualified surgeon.
Is that okay with you?
Before surgery. It reduced back surgery by 40%. We have too many surgeons. We don't have enough primary physicians. We don't have enough of most other types of physicians. Our medical education system is continuing to produce in the postgraduate years too many surgeons, not enough primary physicians. Now, the AMA may feel about this the way that most of us do, but they're not doing anything about it.
Is that their fault?
Can we challenge his allegation? I think I know where his figures on this too many surgical operations come from. At least in Pennsylvania, we used to have an insurance commissioner by the name of Denenberg who used the allegation about 2 million unnecessary surgical operations. And it came from a most peculiar source. It came from a book anonymously written, and the doctor used a pen name.
It's not my source.
And, the way he got his figures was he took the number of operations per 100,000 people in England and in this country. Now, the curious thing is that you mentioned is absolutely true. There's a shortage of hospital beds. You can, in places in England, wait 3, 4, and 5 years for admission for elective surgery, so an awful lot of it doesn't get done.
And that reduces the figures.
And then the author of the book himself said nobody has ever really decided whether they're doing less than a necessary amount of surgery or less than a desirable amount of surgery in England, whether we're doing too much in this country. And then you have the perennial arguments about which is better, the kid who is getting repeated sore throats and attacks of tonsillitis, and you can treat him with penicillin and antibiotics and so on, multiplying the risks every time, including hearing loss and a lot of other things, or you can rather simply take his tonsils out. Now, this is not an easy question. I don't mean to imply that I think I'm for sure that taking his tonsils out is the better answer, but these are the kinds of studies that get involved, and when somebody wants to decide what's necessary or unnecessary, I hope it's a qualified surgeon and not an insurance commissioner or somebody in Washington worrying about the figures in the budget.
Well, the data to which I refer has nothing to do with England. It has to do with the Federal Employees Health Benefits Program. And I'd like to have for everybody in this country what federal employees have. Namely, federal employees and their families, over 5 million people, can choose one of three health insurance plans. They can choose to be covered by Blue Cross and Blue Shield, they can choose to be covered by the Aetna Life Insurance Company, or they can choose to join a prepaid group practice plan where the physicians are not paid on a fee-for-service basis.
Well, you're saying they have a choice, but you're prescribing something that has no choice at all?
Let me give you this, the surgery figure, because the people who join the prepaid group practice plan and their families with the same demographic characteristics as other federal employees have 40% less surgery performed on them. Less female surgery, fewer tonsillectomies, less back surgery, fewer appendectomies, 40% fewer. Now, argument is made that some of these people go outside the system in which they get their basic medical care. even taking into account those who might go outside the system, it's still one-third less surgery than their counterparts who work in the same office. I don't have to look over to England for surgical rates. Right in this country, we have 30 years of experience with prepaid group practice.
But I don't think it answers all of the doctor's questions, because we don't then go on to say, and what's more, those people who didn't have surgery lived longer. That seems to be missing from your syllogism.
Well, he's quoting a book that I've never read, and of course I don't use that as the basis of my data.
Sure. Let's turn briefly to the panel. Ms. Patricia Villela is a graduate from the nursing school at Villa Maria College. Ms. Villela?
Dr. Roth, you seem to use the terms medical care and health care synonymously.
No, I don't mean to.
Would you have provisions for utilizing other professional health care personnel in providing the care, thus decreasing some of your time so you could utilize it better?
Oh, I think this is one of the exciting new developments of the post-World War II era. That is, it's been intensified. We have always had in your profession nurses, and certain kinds of physicians have used them much more extensively as physician extenders, pediatricians, and I think gynecologists and so on. But the concept of the nurse practitioner is being developed now, and other kinds of medical aids. There was a great enthusiasm, or still is, for using those men and women who in the service did medical work and therefore got some kind of initial familiarization and made them perhaps more educable when they got back, so that we're using them. And I think this is one of the most important trade-offs for some of our solutions to how you get medical care to remote areas, how you get medical care into some of the center city areas. The development of new kinds of personnel and their correlation with the physicians.
Dr. James Brassfield is the is a professor of political science at Gannon College in Erie.
Dr. Roth, you've put great stress on the cost of medical care and the cost problem in these various plans. Under the present system, the cost of medical care in the country as a whole, as opposed to national income, the percent of national income has risen in the past 20 years from 5% to 8%. And it would seem to me that any plan, whether it be Medicredit or any of the other plans, is going to medical care, the cost of medical care as a percent of national income is going to continue to rise. And I would like to ask both of you how your particular plan would stop that rise, or maybe it's not going to stop. Maybe it's inevitable that 20 years from now it'll be 10 or 12% of our national income for health care.
I think you've hit an extraordinarily important thing, because I don't think any of us ought to try any sleight of economic hand and indicate that somehow or other there is any free ride in any of these vehicles of deliverance. People are going to have to pay for it in the long run, and if you're going to provide more care for more people, it's going to cost more money. And I don't think that the aggregate cost is going to be influenced in the way Mr. Fine thinks that his plan would influence it, because I think it's just as disastrous to try to motivate a physician to undertreat or underserve as it is to permit him to overtreat or overserve. I don't think we want either one of those. We want the competent physician who's doing his job for the patient and being fairly rewarded. And it's going to cost the same amount under any of these plans. Now, what you've got to decide is how you want to extract this from the public. The new Kennedy-Mills bill adds essentially 4% to the Social Security tax, and I'm not sure the public will be real happy when they realize that. The original Kennedy bill makes it a little bit more like 4.5% new tax on payroll. Our bill doesn't go the payroll tax route, and it doesn't go the administration's route of putting a mandated employer-employee contribution, because we think there are many reasons why this is inequitable and uneven. So what we do is get rid of all of those and distribute it between private capacity to pay and federal revenues. It's the least regressive. It's the most progressive tax we have. It doesn't make the Social Security mistake of charging the low-income fellow just as much as it charges the high-income fellow for the same coverage. So we think that what you say is true. The costs are going to be the same under any system, and we think our method of raising this money...
Well, they won't necessarily be the same under any system. Some systems are more expensive inherently. It's anything that gets tangled in the bureaucracy.
You're correct.
You have to be paid when you make out a form, just as when you take out a tonsil, right? And if you have 10 forms to take out per tonsil, you're going to be more expensive, aren't you?
I think so.
That's why we want to relieve the physician of that particular chore. The average physician practicing alone in his office is spending somewhere between 20 and 35% of his time doing things that other people can do equally well or even better. Not just physician extenders, but secretaries and clerks. But we think that 8% of the GNP is quite enough to be spending for health care.
How do you
Therefore, know? Well, compared to any other country, that means that the average person in this country is working a month every year just to pay for his health care. Now, that's not true of anybody else in any industrial country in Europe or anywhere else. They're not working that long to pay for health care. That's going to be reflected in the cost of American products, as it is. We find in the recently negotiated UAW contracts with Chrysler and General Motors that the Chrysler family, for example, the corporation must pay now $81 a month just for health insurance for that family, for the American Chrysler worker, and $31 a month in Canada, the same right across the border. Well, they have a national health insurance plan there. They originally started by having that administered by the private sector.
Yeah, but they got to pay a hell of a lot more for a Chrysler.
Well, I'm not so sure about that.
What do you mean you're not so sure? It costs about twice as much.
In Canada?
Sure. Taxes.
Well, I think that the fact remains...
Which, Dr. Roth's point, you get it somewhere.
Well, the fact remains that the health security bill is the only one that's anchored to a prospective budget. Mm-hmm. It sets a finite sum of money, starting with where we are, and says that health costs no longer will be permitted to rise 2 or 2.5 times faster than other costs, that they will be permitted to rise just as other costs rise.
It won't work.
The institutional people say that this prospective budgeting that they would impose on them is a way of teaching you to do without a few things like the last 10 days of each month.
Yeah.
Well, some of the best hospital people in the country, conservatives like the late Ray Brown, who was a recognized leader in this field, felt it would work beautifully. That it's quite feasible to negotiate with each hospital. There are only 7,000. You can negotiate budget. You can weed out the waste in the hospital system. You can have hospitals budget not only in terms of their own services,
sure,
but in the
sure
terms
you can.
Of the
but
community.
You, but you're much less likely to do it operating under a hegemony in Washington, D.C., than operating in a system with 50 and even more agencies doing the bargaining for you.
All the administrative action under the program I'm talking about takes place out of the 1,000 local offices of the Social Security Administration, not out of Washington, D.C. We won't need a single additional person in Washington, D.C. under this program. It's already there in Baltimore. It's called Social Security. They have all the records now. They've already contracted with all these hospitals for the Medicare program. They have contracts and arrangements with most of the physicians. It can be done.
Ms. Julie Lesh is a staff member of POX, the Christian Center for Nonviolence. Ms. Lesh.
Thank you. Mr. Fine, I wanted to ask you, you mentioned that one of the most exciting parts of the bills that you're recommending are the encouragement of preventative medicine. Now, will this function to keep the cost of medicine down because diseases are cured when they're small rather than when they get acute?
That's correct. When they're diagnosed at an early point, they certainly are going to result in fewer hospitalizations, lower incidence of surgery, and so forth.
I think we in the medical profession wish it were correct. Unhappily, it has the opposite effect, certainly for the short and medium run. You know, this business of discovering things in physical examinations is not preventive medicine. You're just discovering existing disease earlier. So you get it under treatment earlier, and hopefully the patient lives a little bit longer, so you start earlier and you end up treating it longer. And what you do is increase total costs. And this is the way it proves out. Now, hopefully, in the long run, if you can prevent unnecessary deaths by earlier discovery of disease, you might gain on it. But the problem is that that is not the kind of disability that you generally discover in these kinds of examinations. What you discover is diabetes and hypertension and the things that you don't cure that you got to live with, and you live a longer life with them. So it would be nice, and that doesn't mean it's bad, because if it discovers treatable disease and it happens to be mine, I think it's worth anything that you want to pay for it, and I'll give you the same benefit, but it is not a cost-saving mechanism.
Thank you very much, Dr. Roth, Mr. Fine, ladies and gentlemen of the panel, thank you all.
Next week, Mr. Buckley exchanges ideas on leadership in America with author Joe McGinnis and columnist Murray Kempton. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Production funding provided by public television stations, the Ford Foundation, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.